Welcome to CACE International. I'm fikishac. We have Fred Hóu, baritone saxophone player, who's also the leader of the Afro-Asian music ensemble. How you doing, Fred?
Good, fikishac.
Thanks for coming.
Thanks for having
today.
Me.
Okay.
And the piece that I'm going to do is called Soranbushi, which is based on a traditional Japanese peasant work song that talked about the fishing experience, but when they came to Hawaii to work on the sugar plantations, they became plantation workers. So it's a new song form that developed called the holy holy bushi. Holy holy is a Hawaiian term for the stripping of cane. And it was a music that was sung, it was a vocal music sung exclusively by women. And I'm going to reinterpret this particular folk song. And it's just part of my continuing interest in the folk cultures of multicultural America.
I love it. I love it. That is so catchy.
Oh,
I mean, it's like
thanks.
I want to sing that. Now, tell
me. Well, they were originally sung.
Yeah. It's something I want to keep singing. What is this thing that you did to sound pop?
That's a heavy slap tongue technique. Slap tongue is a woodwind technique in which you use your tongue and you slap the reed In this case, you slap it real hard.
Didn't it hurt your tongue?
Yeah, it does. If you keep practicing, it does. But it was trying to conjure the visual and oral imagery of cane cutters, people whacking cane stalks with machetes.
Okay. So, how would you describe your music?
I have this long phrase to describe my music. I call it Afro-Asian New American Multicultural Music. And that's because I refuse to use the word jazz. I refuse to use the words Negro or Oriental, I refuse to use the word jazz. It's the same context. Even though we may speak English here, our language is colonialism and patriarchy. And if we think about that, a lot of the words and concepts that we have kind of by second nature now utilized are simply extensions of that social context. So I don't use the word jazz per se. You know, I always say so-called jazz or in quotes. I consider my work to be multicultural work in the sense that African American music has been very influential in it. At the same time, my own interest in drawing from Asian folk materials and also materials from around the world, world music, has greatly informed the performance and compositional work that I do. So I don't necessarily categorize it as quote-unquote jazz. And I think it's multicultural American music in this, by the fact that I'm trying to celebrate the heritages other than European in the work that I'm doing.
So you do stuff from Native American?
I'm working on some Native American projects now. I haven't done a whole lot with Native American or indigenous music. So that's an area that I'm getting into a lot more now. I think my initial interest, my primary interest now has been in Native Hawaiian music.
Mm. Who were some of the quote, end quote, jazz people who influenced you?
Certainly, as far as saxophone, John Coltrane and saxophonists of that post-60s generation, people like Archie Shepp. Then I would also say the influence of people like Coleman Hawkins, Leo Parker.
Leo Parker, I don't know that name.
Leo Parker died in his 20s, an African-American baritone player, primarily baritone player, and his music was very, very blues, based, very big in the jump music scene of Texas during the late 1940s, early 50s. As a baritone player, certainly Pepper Adams to Tehamia Blewett to contemporaries. Charlie Parker, to a less degree, less overt degree, like I don't consider myself a quote-unquote bebop player. But I think the thinking process that goes into playing that music has been an area of study of mine for a long, long time.
What is their response to your music, or do they hear from your music what you're conveying to me now?
Most of them find it to be a breath of fresh air. It's very fresh and very exciting because of its radicalness. Both in terms of what I'm trying to do musically as well as what we're trying to project, you know, socially and in the content of our work. So, and I'm very encouraged by that kind of response, because I think what it points to is there's a hunger for something that's in any way different from the very narrow, commercial, so-called mainstream diet that we're fed. I mean, if we want to make a social analogy, what we hear in music, either through television or through radio, is simply the choice between McDonald's or Burger King, or between Pepsi and Coke, which is no real choice at all, or between the Democrats and the Republicans.
Except when you watch CACE INT'L SHOW, then you get a real alternative.
Right, no, but that's exactly it, yeah. Because shows like this, or the work that others who are about what we're about are doing are real alternatives. They're community-based projects. They don't rely on selling ads and they, nor do they rely necessarily on government funding. Oftentimes they're associated with cultural institutions or educational institutions. For example, like radios. To me, the best radio are oftentimes student-run college stations. As far as diversity in programming, willingness to take a risk, information. So I think that these are certain kinds of lessons that we've drawn, you know, in doing our work, and we just have to be clear about the goals that we have and the choices we're going to make.
Wow, this has been quite an education. Thank you so much, Mr. Fred Ho, for joining us and for your visual artwork. And we're going to go out with something from your release, Turn Pain
Into Power.
Thank you so much for joining us on CACE International. I'm Fikisha Kumbo.